Hello everyone, hope you all are doing very well. After few days break, I am again back with last session on multiple pregnancy. Today we'll talk about first course of labor. The duration of labor generally does not prolong due to small sized babies, because in the multiple pregnancy, each baby is relatively smaller in the size. So they are easily delivered. That's why the duration of the labor does not usually prolong. Rarely, second stage of labor may prolong. Labor may be difficult due to malpresentations. Rarely, locking of the twins occur where some part of the fetus gets entangled with the second fetus. Both vertex presentations enter the pelvis, one in advance of the other. This will make the labor difficult. First breech and second vertex presentation. The first presents by vertex or breech and the second transversely. These also makes the labor difficult. Uterine hypertonicity, scanty amniotic fluid and the absence of the amnion favor locking. So whenever these three factors are there, there are more chances of having locking in the twins. The third stage complications are common, like postpartum hemorrhage, shock and retained placenta. Now we come to the prognosis of the condition. Maternal mortality in the twins pregnancy is more than that in single pregnancy. The incidence is higher due to hemorrhage. These hemorrhage can be antepartum, intrapartum or postpartum. Another cause of the higher incidence is preeclampsia and anemia. Maternal morbidity is increased due to complications and increased operative interference. Perinatal mortality is about 4 times more than that in the birth of the single fetus. The reasons for that is prematurity and anoxia. 1/3 loss occurs due to stillbirth. 2/3 neonatal loss occurs due to neonatal death. The second baby is more at risk due to intrauterine anoxia, higher incidence of the operative delivery, retraction of the uterus leading to placental insufficiency, and the increased incidence of the cord prolapse. These affects the fetal circulation and leads to the higher risk. Perinatal mortality of monozygotic twins, that is uniovular twins, is more than that of the dizygotic twins. More male babies are lost than the female babies. It is due to increased risk to the mother and fetus in the multiple pregnancy. There is high risk to the one fetus. So the patient must be delivered in the hospital. Now we come to the last part of this condition, that is the management. Management during pregnancy, during the antenatal period. Earliest diagnosis to take additional care of the mother and of the fetus. Health of the mother is improved by good diet and additional rest. Diet supplement should include all the nutrients to meet the increased demand of the growing fetus. You have to take care of both the fetuses. Close and repeated antenatal supervisions to detect complications. Antenatal rest is important, so adequate rest should be advised at home. The household work should be stopped and complete rest, that is to prevent preterm labor and the other complications. Preterm labor can occur following the premature rupture of the membranes. Patient, if required, is admitted to the hospital in the last month of the pregnancy. Bed rest may not always prevent preterm labor, but helps to treat many conditions. Now management during labor. First, management in the first stage of labor. Patient is kept in bed and the enema is given to prevent early rupture of membrane. Because if the patient is constipated and if patient strains at stool, then this may rupture the membranes earlier. So to avoid that, enema should be given to the patient. Proper sedation is done. Intravenous fluid therapy is advised. It is also implemented. And the patient is closely observed. This was all beyond the routine care that we take in the first stage of labor. I have discussed in detail already the normal labor. In that we have discussed the management in the first stage. So I am here mentioning only the extra points which is required in the multiple pregnancy. Now management in the second stage of labor. With rupture of membranes, vaginal examination is performed to exclude the prolapse of the cord or prolapse of the limb, whatever it is. Wait and watch policy should be adopted. That means any kind of hurry should not be done during the birth of the fetus. The delivery of the first fetus usually occurs spontaneously. Episiotomy may be required for it. If birth of the fetus, the first fetus is delayed due to maternal or fetal distress, then delivery by the forceps or by vacuum extraction or by bridge extraction may be needed. After delivery of the fetus, first fetus, the cord is clamped distally and proximally to prevent bleeding from the divided maternal end of the cord in case of monozygotic twins. Because in monozygotic twins, the bleeding chances will be there. After the birth of the first fetus, again wait and watch policy should be adopted. That means hurry should not be done for the birth of the second fetus. The doctor should wait for 50 minutes after delivery of the first fetus, as the uterus again contracts during this time. Because after birth of the first fetus, there is time for the birth of the second fetus. And for that, uterine contractions are required. So this usually occurs within 15 minutes. During this period, the lie, presentation and fetal heart sound of the second fetus should be checked. If the lie is longitudinal, that means in the vertex or bridge presentation, the presenting part gets fixed on return of the uterine contraction. So when the contractions begin, presenting part will get engaged. Low rupture of membrane with Kocher's artery forceps should be done, and this will lead to spontaneous delivery. If delay occurs, intravenous indocinone drip should be given to hasten the labor. So delay occurs when your contractions are not strong, contractions are dull. So to make the contractions stronger, the indocinone drip may be started. If cord prolapse or fetal distress occurs, delivery is done by forceps or vacuum extraction or bridge extraction. In case of transverse lie, external version is done. That means the fetal position is changed externally. It is made either cephalic or podalic. So either the head is made presenting part, vertex, or it may be the breech. So from the transverse, the lie is changed to longitudinal. If it is not successful, then internal podalic version is done on rupture of the membranes under general anesthesia. And the babies are delivered by breech extraction. Now complications during second stage. There may be vaginal bleeding after birth of the first baby. Delivery of the second baby is hastened by rupturing the membranes and syndosinone drip. If needed, delivery is done by forceps or breech extraction. Pains not appearing within 15 minutes following the birth of the first baby. So usually these pains start, contractions begin within 15 minutes. But sometimes within 15 minutes, contractions may not start again after the birth of the first fetus. So low rupture of membranes is done by Kocher's artery forceps, and this will stimulate the uterine contraction. Another complication is locked twins. This occurs when whenever you find the locked twins, the disengagement under anesthesia is done and the assisted vaginal delivery is done. Sacrificing the first baby as this dies if the first method fails. You may go for cesarean section. Conjoined twins are delivered by cesarean section as their surgical separation is possible later. Conjoined twins are the babies who are attached to each other at somewhere in the body, right? So they can be surgically separated only after the birth. So they are delivered through cesarean section. Now, management during third stage of labor. Prophylactic intravenous ergometrine, that is anti-hemorrhagic drug, should be given immediately on birth of head of the second baby, that is to prevent the postpartum hemorrhage. So this was all about management, and with this I have completed the topic on multiple pregnancy. I hope you could understand it well. Thank you.